we did manage to get away about 40 miles to a location called Dombrova, and when we arrived there, the Germans caught up with us. So basically, we didn't accomplish anything by our attempt to avoid the Germans. As you know, the Polish army was no match to the mighty, mighty German forces, and Poland was occupied within a very short time. But we were stuck at that location for 3 months. We couldn't go back home because there were no means of transportation. Eventually, when we did get back home, we found our apartment looted and my father that we left him behind wasn't there. Any place that we inquired, nobody had an idea what happened to Mr. Wiener. Eventually, they came to us from the Jugendrat, which was a local committee, and they taught my stepmother something which I'll never forget. We know that your husband is missing, but we also know that at the outskirts of our little town is a pit of victims thrown in by the Germans. If you'd like to know whether your husband is one of those victims, we are going tomorrow morning to open that pit in order to identify those victims. What about to happen, the Germans picked up at random 38 people in our little town, mostly Jews, some Christians, and they shot them. They shot them not to be killed instantly, they shot them to bleed, to suffer, until they expired, and then they threw them into a pit, not in a normal fashion, the way you throw in stone. And this happened on September 11, a very infamous day, but this was September 11, 1939. The way they shot them and let them die is a part of the German culture, which is called Schadenfreude. You are enjoying yourself, entertaining yourself, watching other people suffering and dying. So if they were shot on September 11, and we tried to identify those bodies in November 1939, it's very difficult, because if somebody is buried for 3 months, the bodies are partially decomposed. And in those days, we had no DNA. It took a long, long time to identify those bodies. Mm. My stepmother recognized my father's body by the certain items that he had in his clothing that she was familiar with. I was at that point 13 years old. You can imagine what kind of impact a traumatic experience it was on such a young boy. I have nightmares to this very day, although this happened so many years ago, seeing images of my father's partially decomposed face. Mm-hmm. Wow. The following morning, we took those victims in caskets to our cemetery to give them a proper burial. And it took a long time to prepare a mass grave for 38 people. In those days, we had no earth-moving machinery that you see today. People volunteered manually to prepare a mass grave. It took a long time. And I was standing next to my father's casket for many hours, talking to him, crying, praying, asking him a simple question. Daddy, why did he kill you? I didn't understand it at the age of 13, and believe you need it, I don't understand it at the age of 88, and I'm today. Why did they murder my father? He didn't do anything wrong. I was devastated. I talked to him. Where am I going to go? Who's going to take care of me? I'm only 13 years old. I was devastated. It was only after the war that this monument was erected within the Hebrew language. My father is number 23. And this is the official document I received from the Polish government years after the war, that my father was murdered on September 11th. Przeszeń in Polish means September 1939. So obviously life was very, very, very difficult. Every day, the German issued new orders to make our life miserable. one of the very first orders was that our little town became a ghetto, which basically means segregation. We could live only in a very limited area of that little town, and I could go to school anymore. My formal education ended at the age of 13. If I wouldn't have made an effort to educate myself, I would be in deep trouble. I couldn't go to school, even though I liked school. When I come today to an elementary school, or middle school, or high school, and I tell the kids, I'm not a jealous person, but I envy you that you have a chance to get an education when you are young and you have no other responsibilities. And you'd be surprised how many of them, in those 58,000 letters that I've received so far, how many of them promised me to stay in school because they realize how lucky they are. Would you like to know when I graduated from high school? When I came to New York, I had no skills to make a living. I used to clean toilets. But I wanted to improve myself. I went to Brooklyn College. I wanted to learn accounting. So they told me to be admitted to college. Where is your certificate from high school? But I didn't finish high school. I didn't even finish elementary school. So they told me, sorry, young man, you cannot be admitted to college. So the only option I had was to work big time to make a living, study in the evening, submit a test to New York State, and when I did pass that test, they gave me that piece of paper which is called equivalent to high school diploma. And with that piece of paper, I was admitted to Brooklyn College and I learned accounting in the evening. I became an accountant, and that is how I made a living till I retired at the age of 73. But basically, believe you me, there are so many people, young people, when they see it, they get the message, how important, how lucky they are. It reminds me the other day, I went to buy a pair of sneakers in Hillsborough, and this young lady approached me, she said to me, may I help you? And I said, yes, please. And she said, oh my God, I know who you are. You spoke to my school about a year ago. So I told her, I'm glad that you recognized me. Then she said, you know something? My mother would like to hug you and kiss you. Said, I'm ready. You don't know why. I'll tell you why, she said, because when you came to my school, this was the time that I intended to quit school. I was born to fight school. But listening to you, I just realized how lucky I am. And I told Ma, I'm going to work that shoe store part-time and continue my education. Obviously, I'm so gratified because I know how difficult life is if you don't have an education. And in those thousands of letters, there are many young students who promise me to stay in school, and it makes me feel very good. So I couldn't go to school, and as I said, our little town became a ghetto. There are so many restrictions, but there was no mess murder in 1939-40. As it started later on. But in 41, in the middle of the night, the Germans knocked at the door of our apartment and they took my older brother away. Once somebody was deported, couldn't write, he couldn't call, we had no idea what happened to him. If he was alive, there wasn't. 1 year later, in June 1942, in the middle of the night, the German busted into our apartment. They looked at me, they didn't ask my age. They just told me in the German language, you have a few minutes to get ready. My stepmother pleaded with the German, he's such a young boy, he's 15 years old, he needs a mother, don't take him away from me, I love that boy. What did the Germans do? They slapped on my face, you dare to question our action? She fell unconscious, and they took me away. I never had a chance to say goodbye to my stepmother and to my younger brother. What did the Germans do with me? They put me into a wagon like that. They call it boxcar, cattle car. I'm sure that some of you have seen documentaries like Schindler's List or The Pianist, and you're familiar with it, that image. But picture yourself, 80 people were pushed into that camp. Nothing to eat, nothing to drink for a day and a half. We were all standing all the time. There was no room for to sit down. One of us did die. He died in practice. There was no one to fall. There are no words in the dictionary to describe that hellish calm. After a day and a half, I arrived at my first slave labor camp called Blechhammer in Germany. Upon arrival, I was beaten for no reason. But then something unexpected happened to me. One of those prisoners in that camp recognized me from my hometown, told me, "Do you know that your brother's in this camp?" So he took me to meet my brother. I did not recognize my own brother. Not seeing him for 1 year, he aged 10 years. It was one of the most traumatic experiences in my life that I could not recognize my own brother. Why did he deteriorate to such an extent that I couldn't recognize him? Let me give you just an idea of the condition of those slave labor camps. Just an idea. 28 people were housed in a very small room, 8 by 10. 8 by 10 is a very small area. 3 bunks, no mattresses, just straw infested with roaches and lice. They gave us 2 slices of bread in the morning, and the bread was made out mostly of sawdust. Sawdust. It wouldn't be edible to any person who had more or less a normal life, but we had no choice. We didn't get anything else. Lunch, we never got lunch. And in the evening, coming back after a long day of hard work, they gave us a soup, very diluted. You were lucky to find a floating potato or another vegetable. So obviously, people were dying constantly on starvation. And to die on starvation is a very painful way to die from. I experienced starvation, and I know how painful it was. According to my reading, 15 million people, including 4 million Russian prisoners of war, died in those camps on starvation. It's very, very, any other way to die from is easier than to die on starvation. At the very first day marching to work, I learned something which is very, very important. And I can see that you are attentive. Please remember that. I had the impression that only me, because I happened to be a Jewish boy, that I was oppressed. Marching to work, I saw so many different groups. Each group had a different veg and textured garment to identify them. Who were they? Jehovah's Witness, gypsies, homosexuals, undesirables, maybe 30, 40 different groups marching to the same place, being oppressed to a certain extent the way I was oppressed. What did I learn? Every Jew was a victim, but not every victim was a Jew. Please remember that. Every Jew was a victim, but not every victim was a Jew. It is my personal conviction, if Hitler would have won the war, you wouldn't be sitting here in a free society. Hitler had a plan. Heute Deutschland, morgen über alles. Today we are in Germany. Tomorrow we shall be everywhere. You don't have blue eyes and blonde hair? You are not a pure-blooded German? I'm going to enslave you. And if I feel like, I'm going to annihilate you. You are inferior. This is very well documented. So we are all lucky that Hitler did not win the war. What do you see here? This is a German woman. But she had to have not blue eyes and blonde hair. They measured her scalp to be sure that she's pure German race, Aryan race. I'm asking you, Does this make any sense? To determine somebody's ability or character based on the color of the hair, or the color of the eye, or the color of the skin? If you have an open mind, you will realize this entire ideology, or the entire craziness of Hitler and his cohorts doesn't make any sense. You know, Voltaire, the 18th century French philosopher, said, those who can make you believe absurdities can make you commit atrocities. And prejudice and stereotyping is absurd. So, in that camp, was not for it, I was only for 4 months. There's one episode which I would like to share with you. At the very first week, while I was working, at the working place, we could get in touch with other nationalities. A Pole approached me and he talked to me in the Polish language. I see that you have a watch, a wristwatch. Give me your watch, I'll give you a loaf of bread. I was very hungry. I gave him the watch. He never gave me the loaf of bread. I don't know how this evolved, but in the evening, coming back to our camp, there was a roll call. We all had to assemble at the center of the camp, and the commander said like that, today, at the working place, one of you prisoners gave away this watch for 20 loaf of bread, and as you know, this is a crime. If that prisoner doesn't step forward and admit this crime, you are all going to be punished collectively. You'll be standing here the entire night and go to work tomorrow morning like any other day. So I mentioned at the beginning I was brought up with certain values, and one of them was that I was responsible for my own action. I did step forward, and that is what I said. I'm the one that gave away my watch for a promise of bread because I am so hungry, and I know that my brother is hungry too. So all the others, there were 2,000, were dismissed to their barracks, and I was taken into a punishment room. They gave me 15 strokes on my dead body. Just to give you an idea, I committed a crime by giving away my watch. By miracle, God's will, somehow, I survived that ordeal. When I came out from that punishment room, my older brother was standing there, praying and thanking God that I was still alive. That gives you an idea, the condition in those camps. From that camp, I was sent to my second camp called Branden, also in Germany. A very, very hard work, it was winter time. I still this very day, 2 toes, that there's no life in them because of frostbite. The commander in that camp was such a sadist. He enjoyed torturing us. That's a part of the culture. He enjoyed torturing us. He took me and some others into a cold bathroom in the middle of the night, standing underneath a cold shower, forcing us to be standing underneath a cold shower for the entire night. And he was standing there, enjoying himself, entertaining himself, watching us suffering and dying. If you are standing underneath a cold shower for the entire night, you can die. There's one episode that I would like to share with you, which is very interesting. It is not mentioned in my book because it happened recently. One day somebody called me from Michigan University and he introduced himself, I am a German professor teaching German literature in Michigan University. I am calling you because my father was involved in that camp wonder. I have been living with a guilt feeling my entire life. I have been looking for survivors of that camp. I found one in Australia and one in Canada. And now when I went to the internet, I see that you wrote a book from a name to a number and you are mentioning that camp wonder. I'm calling you to ask you forgiveness. And I told them right away, there's nothing for me to forgive you. You're not responsible for your father, action and action. We were on the phone for about half an hour, and I convincing that I don't hate him because of the action of his father. That is the way I feel. I am not against the German generation of today. I mean, he's not responsible for his father. So this is not mentioned in my book because it happened recently. But anyway, I was in that camp only for 2 months, and then the German decided to send me to another camp called Großmaster. The conditions are very similar in all those camps. Same kind of food, same kind of shelter, being beaten every day, and so on. But there's one thing which happened to me in that camp Großmaster, which I would like to share with you. It's very interesting. In those 58,000 letters that I received so far, there are many references to that episode that I'm going to share with you. And again, I appreciate that you are so attentive, but I'm pleading with you. Think about it. When you come home, try to analyze it, okay? At one point, I worked in a textile factory together with German employees, mostly women, because men were drafted to the army. The German employees worked in that part of the factory, operating textile machinery, and we prisoners were in that part of the factory, dismantling old machines and putting up new machines. And there were signs all over the factory in the German language addressed to the German employees. Don't give anything to the prisoners. Don't talk to them. Don't make even eye contact with them. And if you do, you are doomed. One day, when I was sitting there with this man's machine, a middle-aged German woman on the way to the restroom did make eye contact with me. And she hinted to me with her finger like that. I had no idea what she meant. I was very curious. I had a feeling that it must be something important. But I had to watch myself that nobody else should notice me approaching that indicated sight. Eventually, I did find the right moment, and what happened? I found a sandwich of 2 slices of white bread with a slice of cheese hidden underneath a box. That German woman repeated that noble act of leaving a sandwich for me every day, for 30 days, as long as I worked at that location. She risked her life for me, not once, 30 times. Whenever she put the sandwich on her, she definitely risked her life. That is what all the signs indicated. She would be executed instantly if she would be caught. I don't have a yardstick to measure to what extent it helped me to survive. Just on only 30 days out of 1,050 days that I was incarcerated. But the question here is, why? What motivated her? Why was she willing to risk her life for a young Jewish boy? She heard on the radio and she read in the paper every day that I'm an Untermensch, top human, and she is a master race. Why was she willing to risk her life for a young Jewish boy? What comes to your mind? I don't know. I never will. But she's my heroine to the last day of my life, not just because of the practical help, giving me sandwiches. She taught me a very important lesson. And I'll tell you why. 3 weeks prior to that, a German guard punched me and knocked out many of my teeth. I have no teeth. He was a German and she was a German. They're both German nationals. But look at the difference. One was wicked and the other one was a righteous person. What did I learn? That you are going to find good people and bad people in every group. That prejudice is stereotyping is absurd. She's a German woman. She might have a son at my age, and she lived her life for a young Jewish boy. I am so grateful to her. She is in the back of my mind every day. I can just tell you that after the war, I made an effort to locate her. I went to that location. I went to City Hall, pleading with them to help me to locate a woman that risked her life for me in 1943, 30 times. What's her name? What's her address? They looked at me to be insane. How can you locate anybody if you don't know a name or her address? But Raji didn't play a role. I was so anxious to meet that lady. Excuse me. You know, wherever I go to schools, most of my audiences are schools. The elementary, middle, high, colleges. And I always suggest to the teachers, invite parents. And apartheid has a very important impact when parents come. It affects even the relationship between parents and children. But in one elementary school in Portland, one of the parents happened to be Trudy Ludwig, a very famous children's book writer. So when she had a story about a German woman who risked her life for me, it gave her an idea. Most of the children's book have to do with bullying, which is going on and going in schools. She got the idea to write a book about the German woman that gave me the sandwich. And this book just came out last week, and it is on Amazon, and the name of the book is Gift from the Enemy. It's a very, very good book that they all told me. It is about my life and about the German woman. So if you're interested, it's available on Amazon. So I told you about those three camps. From that camp, it was Masaryk, I was sent to my fourth camp called Klettendorf, also in Germany. At that point, the Germans started to lose the war, because this was already yesterday. We just celebrated or commemorated the D-Day of June the 6th. And my job was to dig trenches. In other words, the Germans started to prepare that they might be overrun. So my job was to dig a trench against incoming tanks. And one day when I was digging a trench, I came across a raw potato. I picked up the raw potato, ate, dirty, unpeeled, raw. A new arrival from Belgium was certainly eating a raw potato, said to me, "How in the world can you eat a raw potato? How can you take this humiliation, this beating every day?" I just came back from Belgium. I had a wife and a child, good business. I'm not going to take it. And I tried to reason with him. If you would have experienced 2.5 years camp life the way I did, you'd be lucky to find a raw potato. It tasted better than to eat snow. I used to eat snow to survive. You have no idea what starvation means. You might be hungry once in a while, but if you are starving, you will eat anything that you can put your hands on. I was happy to find a peel of a potato in a garbage can. You have no idea what starvation is. And he really couldn't last long. From that camp, I was sent to my fifth camp, and this was my last camp called Baldwin, a race concentration camp. Upon arrival, they were stripped naked. Everything that I still had from home, like I mentioned before, pictures, or birth certificate, or my clothing, everything was taken away from me. They gave me a uniform consisting of a jacket, trousers, a shirt, a coat, a jacket, no underwear, and a number, 64735. They never called me by my name again. Can you imagine to what extent you are dehumanized? You don't have a first name, a last name, just a number. In that camp, we were so isolated that I did not see a female, a woman, or a child for 8 months. I didn't see a flower or a meadow for 8 months. I didn't see my own face because there were no mirrors. When I was liberated for the first time and I looked at the mirror, and I wondered, who that guy from? I don't know how to believe. How can people survive in this kind of environment? I had eyes greater than eyes. I have hands greater than hands. I couldn't write, or nothing to write with or to write on. I couldn't touch anybody. Nobody touched me. I had ears the way you had ears. I could listen to the sound of music. All I could hear was yelling at me, shouting at me, and telling me every day that I'm no good, that I'm inferior. On what basis, I'll never know. I had eyes, as I said, like you, but I couldn't read, there was nothing to read. And since there was nothing to read, and we had no radio, we had no idea what was going on in the world. So on May the 9th, 1945, we assembled to go to work like any other day. But the German guards that ordinarily escorted us to our working place didn't show up. And we wondered why. About 1 o'clock, a tank of the Russian army approached our gate, and the officer came out and he told us, you are free. At that point, we realized that the Germans lost the war. When the Russian soldiers saw our emaciated bodies, they felt sorry for us. They broke down and they cried like babies. And they told us, you can go out to the city, kill Germans, take revenge. We know how you feel, because we lost 22 million of our own people. I didn't go out to kill, it got great in me. And then I had no strength to move. So I continued to stay in that camp on my own bunk until a German family who lived in that vicinity came to our camp, either out of compassion or out of fear that we are going to take revenge, and they offered me to stay in her house, which I did. I did stay in her house for a few weeks, and then when I regained some strength, I went back to Poland to see if somebody of my family survived. This was the only way to find out. Even the Red Cross couldn't provide you with reliable information who survived or who did not survive. So I did stay in Poland for a few weeks, and only 4 cousins of mine did show up. And all the rest, as I mentioned before, 123 members of my extended family, they were all murdered, and I'm the only survivor of my immediate family. That's the way how I looked after the war. And this is a few months later. I just put on the jacket as a souvenir. It just shows you the difference. If you are able to eat more or less normally, how it affects how you feel or how you look. You see here at the very first picture, no girl paid attention to me, but here they changed their mind. As mentioned before, I received an honorary bachelor degree by Wiener Pacific College in Portland. I was very humbled. And I told the audience this was a commencement. They all became PhDs, about 1,000 people. They gave me a standing ovation. And I told them how humbled I am. I had 2 dreams again. One dream was a day should come that I should be able to match bread as I want, was to sleep on a mattress. Thank God this materialized. But I never dreamt that one day I'm going to be under by such a distinguished audience. We are all PhDs, I didn't finish high school. So Professor Barber came, the president of the college, came to the podium and he said, Mr. Wiener, I promise you that we PhDs can learn more from your life experience than you can learn from all of us. By the same token, I hope that you too are able to get something out of my life experience. This is another Lewis and Clark Law School decided to give me an honorary law degree because the dean happened to read my book and he felt that my book is very educational. I was very humbled to be given such an honor. If you remember at the beginning, I mentioned to you the 3 reasons why I make an effort to share my story. And one of them was people deny the Holocaust. This is one of the pictures that I sent to the president of Iran. What do you see here? The German, this picture taken by a German, cannot be a fake. The Germans came to our houses. They took the elderly, the very elderly, and the very young, they were taken directly to killing centers. I know for a fact that my younger brother, at the age of 10, was taken on February 18, 1943, to Auschwitz. Most people don't realize that, that most victims of the Holocaust were very young and the elderly. I was taken to work because they didn't need to be fit for work. But my little brother, at the age of 10, was not taken to work, was taken to a killing center. There are 6 killing centers in Poland, Majdanek, Tuzlinka, Auschwitz, Chelno, where the very young and the elderly were taken directly to be killed. This is another picture taken by a German soldier, who taken those women, men, and children directly to be murdered. This picture taken by an American soldier in her shoes, taken away from those very young children before they were pushed into the gas chamber. Every day when I take a shower, I look at the shower head and I talk to myself, what went through the mind of my little brother that at the age of 10 he was pushed into a gas chamber? He lived over there for a few minutes, and then instead water fired from the gas choked him to death. How much did that little boy suffer? And why? Who had a heart to murder a million and a half children under the age of 14 in such a brutal way? And people say, had the nerve to say it didn't happen. General Eisenhower gave an order to the American soldiers, take pictures of those liberated camps, because one day somebody might say it didn't happen. And he was, unfortunately, he was so correct. What did Eisenhower, Bradley, and Patton find in those liberated camps? Mounds and mounds and mounds of dead bodies. And those who were walking were half dead. So somebody tells you it did not happen. In the Nuremberg trial, it lasted for 11 months, from November 1945 till October 1946. Those 24 German officials and military commanders, they didn't deny the Holocaust. All what they did say to their defense was, we had to follow Hitler's order. But they didn't deny the Holocaust. Babi Yar, in the Ukraine, hundreds of thousands of people were forced to dig their own graves, and then they were shot with one bullet and buried half alive. In fact, there's now a priest in France by the name of Patrick Devoir that he dedicates his life to find mass graves in the Ukraine and Russia, and so far he located 860 mass graves of those innocent people. So people denied the horror. This picture was taken by a British soldier in Bergen-Belsen. That is what they found in those liberated camps. Mounds and mounds of dead bodies. This man in the middle is my schoolmate. We went together to school. He died one day after the war. This picture was taken by an American soldier. Why did he die? Thousands and thousands of Holocaust survivors died soon after the war because they couldn't digest the normal food given to them by the Americans, the British, and the French. They didn't understand. You cannot give somebody who had been deprived of basic nutrients for so long, you cannot give them a hamburger. The body is not going to assimilate it. Unfortunately, many, many thousands of Holocaust survivors died soon after the war. This was written by a German clergyman a few months after. I would would appreciate if you all read it. You just know I can hear you. There's a message here. Please go ahead. Can you read it, please? Let me hear you.
First they came for the communists,
and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a communist.
Then they came for the Jews,
and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for the trade unions,
and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a trade unionist.
Then they came for the Catholics, but I didn't speak up because I wasn't a Protestant. Then they came for me, and by that time there was no one else.
That's a very, very timely message. Because if you see injustice, unfairness, do something about it. Because that same clergyman accused the entire world for not doing more to stop the Holocaust. The Holocaust was going on, the slaughter was going on for so many years. And somebody could have stopped it, but he didn't. This is not my day, don't misunderstand. This is the German exchange student who came to the United States, and she, in Newburgh, one day she came to interview me, and at the door she told me, you probably hate me because my grandfather was a Nazi. And I told her right away, I don't hate you, I have no reason to hate you, you're not responsible for your grandfather. And that just makes sense, and we became very good friends. Another fact, she was here from Germany to visit me just a week ago. Because when she said to me, you probably hate me, I told her the story about the German woman who risked her life for me. This happened to me in Gerson High School. At the end of my presentation, a young student approached me. She said to me, I heard you, but I didn't see you. Initially, I didn't understand what she meant, but the principal who was sitting next to me told me that that student is legally blind. She just heard me, but she didn't see me. But then later on, I got an email from her telling me that I changed her life. Why? Because I mentioned in my presentation that under Hitler, any baby that was born with any kind of problem, health problem, was nervous by the doctors and the nurses. Hitler gave an order, he doesn't want any sick people. He gave an order to the hospitals. So any baby that was born with any kind of a problem was nervous by the doctors and the nurses. The same doctors, when they graduated from medical school and they gave the Hippocratic oath that they're going to be compassionate, they became nervous. But she realized she would be born in Germany. With impaired vision, she would be murdered as an infant. So the school decided to have a play based on my life story, and here she is playing the role of one of those infants. This is the book that just came out, I mentioned this before. And this is very briefly, my life story. Time left, if you have any questions for me, there are very, very few Holocaust survivors still around. This might be your last chance. I'm just here. I'm 88 and I'm one of the youngest. The main reason I'm here because I'm so busy, I have no time to die. If you have no questions, I have a question. Did you learn anything today?
Yes.
Are you willing to tell me what you learned?
I was wondering what you did in the concentration, in the work camps, to keep a sense of hope or to have a sense of community.
What kept me going? That's the question?
Yes, so personally, what kept you going? And then as a group, were there any kind of activities or things as a group, like within the room, that were people singing? Did people have anything that they did to try to keep a sense of community?
Well, kept me going. I wanted to live, you know. I had no life before. I was a little boy. What did I know about life altogether? So I was afraid to die too. There were people who just gave up. They just stopped eating and they died. Basically, we had no means how to kill ourselves. We had no weapon. We had no drugs. To kill yourself, you need something. We had nothing. So the best way to do was if you just stop eating and you die. I didn't want to die. I wanted to go back home to my environment of a loving family. This was family in those days was the focus of life. So this gave me strength. And then I was brought up in a very religious home. Very religious home. They took away from me my prayer book, but I continued to pray all the time. At work, from work, to work, at the camp, because I remembered most of the prayers by heart. So I hope that somehow God is going to come to my rescue. I never gave up my faith, and I never gave up hope. And I think that hope and faith. Let me tell you something, which is very, very important. March 1945, I was so emaciated, I couldn't work anymore. So the way the system worked, if you cannot work, you cannot be utilized, they kill you. But there was no crematorium in that camp Wallenberg, so they sent me to a killing center. I was standing alone. I saw the chimney. I was so scared. I knew that my life was coming to an end. All of a sudden, a German entrepreneur approached me, and he shouted at me, "Come on, Ausnahme, du kannst doch bei der Arbeit kapieren. Get out of that line, young boy. You can still work and expire at work." And he sent me back to work. And a few weeks later, I was free. Never give up hope. You never know. You never know. On the lighter note, if I may share with you, and this happened a long time ago, I went to a high school, and the young student asked me, "How old are you?" So I gave him my age. So he said, "How come that you lived so long? You suffered so much?" I don't know. God knows. What I can tell you is my lifestyle. I don't drink alcohol, I don't smoke, I'm a vegetarian, I don't take drugs. This might have something to do with my longevity. So he said to me, "Are you telling me that you have no vices?" Vices. I was thinking about, okay, I have two vices, I like chocolate and woman. So he said, me too. Wait, this is not the end of the story. The following year, I was invited to the same school, and the teacher, a female teacher, presented me with a bar of chocolate. I was in early, I'm not being paid for coming here, I'm not being paid any place, and she gave me, she said, "I remember your two vices from last year. I can satisfy you with one vice." But if you come next year, we shall see.
My question is, after you've went through your schooling and accomplished for a career, do you have a, can you tell us a little bit about your current, did you have a family, did you marry, do you have children, and can you tell us a little bit about your family now?
I'm sorry, I have a huge problem.
She's asking about your family, your wife, and your children.
Oh yeah, I got married. Most of the Holocaust survivors married and other Holocaust survivors. 98% of Holocaust survivors married and other Holocaust survivors because they felt nobody is going to understand it. In my case, I didn't marry a Holocaust survivor. I've been married for many, many years. Unfortunately, my wife has been in a nursing home for many years with Parkinson. I have two sons and six grandchildren. I cannot compete with my great-grandfather. If you read my book, you'll see that he had 28 children and about 250, 28 children and 250, two grandchildren. I can have two beautiful children. That's what I have.
Any other questions?
Okay, I'm going to come back around.
I read your book, and my question is, I know that you were in Israel for a while after the war, and I wondered, why did you choose to become an American citizen instead of staying in Israel?
If you did read my book, the reason that I came to the United States are mentioned in my book. I had a lot of problems because I lived for so many years on that constant tension, and there was plenty of tension about security in Israel at that time. And then I wanted to be reunited with my four cousins that survived the war, and they were in the United States. So I came here in 1960, and I appreciate every day that I live in this great country. For me, Thanksgiving Day is every day. That's all I can tell you.
Yes, sir. They say that history has a way of repeating itself. Can you ever see this happening again?
It's a very good question. The question is, it might happen again?
Could it happen again?
It's definitely, it's happening, basically, it is happening. When I was liberated, I was sure it's not going to happen again, that they won't learn something from the Holocaust. But we had so many problems. If you remember, Biafra, Kosovo, Rwanda, these were minor Holocaust. It might happen again because for the same reason, prejudice, stereotype. A jihadist is going to come to you today and tell you, if you don't believe in Muhammad the way I believe, you are an infidel, and it's my religious duty to kill you. That's what they say. What did Hitler say? If you are not a German, you are in my way. I have to remove you. If I kill you, I'll have no food for my own people. So basically, it's the same mentality, there's only one difference. If, God forbid, we do have another Holocaust today, it's going to be much more damaging than the Holocaust in World War II. Because the needs of destruction today are much more powerful than during the Holocaust. To kill 6 million, there was a big population. You picked up the people from home, you ship them or transport them to Auschwitz, then you cremate them. Today, you can kill millions of people with one small device or biological weapon, and that's what's happening. We live in a very dangerous time. The way I understand what can be done is the same thing what I said before. To build up the children from the very beginning, to educate them, convince them that prejudice and stereotyping is absurd. We are all God's children. On what basis? Thank you. On what basis, tell me, did Hitler consider me to be inferior? The other day I spoke at Concordia University, and one of the students stands up and he said, Mr. Wiener, you keep saying that God, that Hitler considered you to be inferior. Wasn't Albert Einstein a Jew? But yes, Albert Einstein happened to be a Jew. He wasn't a genius because he was a Jew. He just happened to be a Jew, But he was not inferior, for God's sake. Jonas Salk, the one who invented the vaccination against polio, according to my reading, he saved 700 million lives. According to Hitler's definition, Jonas Salk was inferior because he happened to be a Jewish person. Does this make sense to you? If you just have an open mind and a sense of common sense, you'll come to the same conclusion that it doesn't, that prejudice makes no sense. And if you read about Hitler, the more you read about him, you'll realize that he was not under president, he was a crazy man. In 1937, his personal doctor told him, Hitler, you are a genius, but you are insane. And insane he was. His main problem was he didn't know how to love. He had no one. All those people around him, Hess, Himmler, Goebbels, he hated all of them. He hated himself. Did he love the German people? If he loved the German people, how come that in April 1945, when his general came to him telling him, we are losing the war, you know what he told them? Destroy the infrastructure of Germany. If we are going to lose the war, we don't have to live. So did he have enough for the German people when he gave an order to destroy the German people? Do you have an idea how many Germans were killed in World War II? 9 million Germans, 5 million military, and 4 million civilians. What did he achieve? What did he achieve with his brutality and his prejudice? Just misery. 62 million people were killed in World War II because of one crazy man. And you know the main problem his was? He did not know how to love. He gave an order to the Department of Education to tell the teachers to teach the children to love hatred. Yeah, very enlightenment. He did not know how to love. Know something? His girlfriend, Eva Braun, she confided to her girlfriend that he didn't even know how to make love to her. He should have consulted me.
If you had one more chance, what would it be?
He wants to know if you had anything, if you could do anything, what would it be?
If I would be a teacher?
If you could be anything.
Huh?
If you could do anything or be anything, what would you do or be?
I would make a laugh.
You got that on camera, right?
I
I served in Germany in the middle 1980s, right before the Berlin Wall came down. We were taking some friends and I were taking a tour of some of the different graveyards and cemeteries, and an old man came in. He was in his late 60s, and he was riding pushing a bicycle. And he heard us talking, and he realized that we were Americans, and he became enraged, and he came after us and started throwing rocks and trying to throw his bike at us and everything. And so he used a lot of bad language, but I hate you Americans, you killed my family and you killed my wife. And so I finally had to restrain him because I didn't want him to get hurt somehow. So anyway, I talked to him and I said, why? I said, do you know why we are here, and how can you be so hateful after the millions of people that Hitler and your officers killed? And he said he was doing what needed to happen. And I still think about that occasionally because I feel, I don't know in my own mind if he was brainwashed, you know, and in the military, or if he just didn't understand the whole story, I guess.
Well, if he was referring to what happened during the Allies bombardment, we know that many civilians were killed, especially 1944, 1945. But they invited it. Hitler invited it. The United States had no other way. You know, if the United States would not have joined the war, what would have happened? According to historians, they believe that The new church is he's the only one who understood the menace of Nazism. And when he came to Roosevelt in January 1941, and he pleaded with Roosevelt to join the war effort. Roosevelt was reluctant because the people in the United States didn't want to go to war. But if Hitler would have joined, I mean, if the United States would have joined the Allies in January 1941, instead, defenders of Iran, after Pearl Harbor, millions of people's lives could have been saved. There was no, you see, Hitler didn't intend to stop in Europe. He had a plan to take over the United States, to take over the entire world. I just mentioned before, heute Deutschland, morgen über alles. Today we are in Germany, tomorrow we shall be everywhere. So by joining the war effort, the United States prevented a world catastrophe, to my understanding. Now the German is angry that the Allies bombarded the big cities. Apparently, they didn't have another choice to subdue the German. They were very strong. You know, according to some historians, believe that if the United States wouldn't have won the war, or the war would have gone on for another few months, Hitler would have had the atom bomb. Then he wouldn't care.
I just have a comment. When I told my children that I was coming to this and asked them if they could come, one of my daughters said that she heard you speak at Clackamas Community College a while back, and she said that it was very, very humbling to hear you speak, and I wanted to convey that to you and to let you know that I have been fortunate enough to hear some world leaders speak in person, and I am honored and I'm very, very humbled to be in this room listening to you. Thank you.
Thank you for your complimentary comment, and if you are here because your daughter's recommendation, I owe her commission.
Mr. Wiener, thank you very much. I have a question for you. I am a product of the 50s of America. And my wife's father and my father fought against the Germans. My question is, I love this country. I also have served in the military. But I am deeply concerned what's happening in this country now. Do you see, sir, any problems that America is going down the same road that Germany did? And do you see that, I know that you believe in education. My wife was a teacher for 20-some years, and I believe in education.
Did I speak in her class?
Pardon me, sir?
Did she invite me to talk in her class?
Well, she's not teaching anymore. She's retired. But she would. But anyway, my question is, and I guess it's multiple, do you see the same thing happening in America? Our schools are not schools of education, in my opinion. There are good teachers, but they're being brainwashed in this country. We are losing the greatness. Our church, we're not a righteous nation anymore. We've become an unrighteous nation. I see America going down the same road that Germany did, and I have German ancestors, but I'm just curious what you see. You saw it happen in Poland. You saw it in Germany. What do you see equivalent happening to America?
Thank you for that kind of good question. To be very frank, I'm very concerned. And I do go to many schools, and I do talk to teachers and principals, and I read, we have a serious problem, but I don't see it as it happened in Germany because this is a big country. I give you a very good example. An American professor wrote a book which is called Terror Thrives at War. In that book, he's documenting a letter from a German soldier to his wife in Germany. How are you? How are the kids? I don't think that we are going to win the war. Because of that comment, you are executed. In other words, you have freedom of speech. You can go out here and say, I hate Obama, I hate Bush. Nothing is going to happen to you. You couldn't do it in Germany. If you just said, I hate Hitler, they would execute you. My point is, I'm very concerned, and immediately what I see in the schools, I don't like. I read the 58,000 letters that I have around, many of those letters from college students, they don't fit their level of education. I am very concerned, but there's no comparison to my understanding, based on my life experience, to the kind of regime we had under Israel.
Any other questions?
Can I wait overnight or what?
Immediate family.
Yes, I did, but my older brother.
Yeah.
I didn't mention.